so for those of you that just came in, to access the files we're going to be using, it's going to be on the class shares. So you go on your desktop, and in the class shares folder, there is a folder called workshop_film1, and then from there, you're going to copy and paste the After Effects folder onto your desktop. You see it? Good? All right, awesome. Okay, and then so from your desktop, once you have that folder copied, we can open up that After Effects file. Let me just open up this one. So I'm going to show you what ideally will be the final result of this workshop.
So I'm saying missing fonts, but I assume that's a big deal.
Yeah. I thought I used fonts that were included in After Effects, but
it says
I think I used
Helvetica is unresolved, which seems odd.
Yeah, right? I thought Helvetica was like a default font that's included. But anyways, it's okay. It doesn't matter. It's just going to replace it with another font.
For sure.
So, yeah. So this is what we're going to try to achieve today, hopefully, if we don't run out of time. Ta-da!
It's beautiful.
Yeah! Okay, so this is, it's kind of, the way I split this workshop up is there's two parts. So part one is this first part, which is green screening and compositing and color correcting. And then part two is this animation using the page turn effect and some track mats. So giving you tips and tricks on how to make something that looks very cheesy at first and make it work for you and look believable and realistic. It's more so teaching you the mindset to use when you start using the effects in After Effects. So yeah. Let's get started. Okay, so I'm gonna, if you open up the folder that says Annie's project, it has everything that's finished. So if you ever lose track or you need to, you know, quickly catch up, everything's here. So if you need anything, it's all there. But if you have any questions or if you need me to clarify anything, obviously stop me and ask a question. That's no problem. So I'm just going to go through very quickly, just an overview of how we're going to do this. So if you go into the final comp, you double click that, it'll open it up, and then you'll see all the different layers here. So part one is right here, and if I just scrub through it, you'll see that it's the final video that we just saw. Okay, so basically what we're going to do, so if I double click on that part one, it's going to open up a new window to show me that composition. And you'll see that I have my background layers, which are the bottom three. And then I have paper texture. I have a few compositions that has the actual animation in it. And then a final adjustment layer that's going to color correct the whole thing. Okay, and then a camera for the camera movement. And then if I go back to my final comp, you'll see that, so that part one is included, and then we have some track mats going on for the second part, which is for that paper whipping effect. And then we also have another camera, and then the text files, which is the text that you see revealed here. Okay? So that's basically how we want to organize our project. So we're going to start from scratch. So you can close these compositions because we won't be using them. I want you to use your own. So the way we're going to start is by importing all the footage. So even though it's already included in the project, I just want to go over this process with you because we're going to be using proxies, and the way you import proxies is a little different. So to import, you can either double click on the project window like this, or you can just go to File, Import. That way works too. And then, so we're going to go to our folder, and I've organized everything for you guys. So under footage, we have all of our backgrounds, we have the paper textures, and then we have a stop motion image sequence that is from my own film. Okay, so this is copyrighted Annie Amaya. Don't use it for anything else. All right. So we're going to start with the image sequences. We can't import everything in all at once, and I'll show you what happens when we do that. Don't do this, I'm just going to show you. If I do this, then it's going to import everything, but it's not going to recognize these as image sequences. It just does this. So we don't need to do that. Okay, so I'm just going to delete that. So go back here. So we're going to start with the image sequences and select them individually so that it does recognize it as an image sequence. So we're going to hit on options here, and then make sure this is checked off, the importer image, importer JPEG sequence. Okay, so you select the very first one, and then this checked off. If you hit open, it should automatically recognize it as an image sequence. And you'll know by that little icon that has like three photo image. Okay, does everyone see that? Yeah? So we're gonna do the same thing for the proxy, but we won't be importing it the same way. So first, we need to interpret this footage so that it's at the right frame rate. Yeah?
Sorry, yes, uncheck or check the box?
Check the box,
oh.
Yeah.
And just import the first image?
Just select the first image, make sure it's checked off, and then it should work. Let me know if it doesn't. Okay? So we're gonna right click on the footage that we just imported, go to interpret footage, main, and this is something that you'll have to do all the time when you're importing image sequences, because the default frame rate that After Effects imports footage is 30 frames, which is not what I used. It was 12 frames per second. Okay, so we're gonna type in 12, where it says assume this frame rate. Okay, and we're gonna hit okay, and that should play it at 12 frames per second. So if I double click that, it's gonna open up the source window to show me, to preview my animation. So that's playing at the right speed, so that's all good. Now you'll notice that if I look over here, this is, oh, I think I imported in the wrong one, sorry. I'm gonna replace the footage, sorry. I don't know if you guys made the same mistake too. Make sure you import it in the green folder. Yeah. Did everyone get it from the green folder, not the other one? If not, just delete it and then re-import it from the green folder, because this is the high resolution one. We need to import in the high resolution one first. And you'll know it's the high resolution one by checking here. In the project window, when you have it selected, it'll tell you the dimensions. So it should be at 5,472 by 3,648. Okay? So obviously this is a really high-res file because I shot it at double res, just in case I wanted to zoom in. And this was done under camera with a light table and a blue gel on top. So it wasn't the best conditions for like green screening, but it's the best that I could do with the school facilities. And I'll show you how to work with bad footage. I purposely picked this because I figured this is the type of footage that most of us will be working with, because it's very hard to get high quality green screen footage if you don't have the right equipment. So now we're gonna set a proxy. And the reason we work with proxies is so that the computer doesn't lag. And on these computers, you won't really notice that big of a difference, but if you're working from a laptop like I am, you'll really notice the difference. So what we're going to do is we're going to right-click on that image sequence again. And there's two things that we can do to make proxies. Proxies are basically like a placeholder, and they're a lower resolution so that it's faster for the computer to render it. So After Effects gives you two options. You can either create a proxy, and what this will do is it'll actually render it out and make either a QuickTime movie out of it or a still image out of it. And that's not what we want, because we already have our low res version of the proxies. Okay, so we're gonna use the set proxy instead. And under file, we're gonna click that, and it's gonna open that same window again. And we're gonna find the other folder that says proxy. The one that's not green, and we're going to do the same thing. Select that first frame, hit options, and make sure this is checked off, the importer JPEG sequence, and we're going to hit open. And if everything worked fine, you should see a little square right beside your image sequence. And this is where you can toggle it on and off to see if your proxy, if you want to switch back and forth from your proxy to your full res, okay? And we're going to do the same thing again for the proxy where we have to interpret the footage. So we're going to right-click on it, interpret footage, proxy, and we get that same dialog window. And we're going to do the same thing. So change it to 12 so that it's at the proper frame rate and hit OK. Is everyone following OK? Yep.
Is it a good idea to make our own lower resolution files, or is it OK if we just let After Effects make them for us?
It's up to you. Like, you can do it yourself.
Does the After Effects one also save it in a different folder? So you have like.
The After Effects one, it'll only either make a QuickTime movie or just a still image. So it won't, I don't think there's an option to export image sequences, but it'll still work even if you have it as a QuickTime movie. But yeah. After Effects does everything for you, but it'll like link it as a proxy. So either way is fine. Yeah.
Do you know if you're working on Windows, it will do what kind of file it would make as a movie? Because Windows usually doesn't afford
it. I'm not sure. Option. Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, I guess it's whatever video format Window uses. So maybe MP4 or something like that? I'm not sure. Yeah, that's a good question. But it doesn't matter anyways, because it's just a placeholder, right? So it doesn't really matter what file format it is. It's just so that it renders faster when you're previewing it. Okay, so now that we have that imported in, we can import the rest of the footages. So import, or double click on the project window. And then we want to import in our background. So go into the backgrounds folder and select Orihim is land. That's what the background is called. We're gonna hit open. And because it's a Photoshop file, After Effects asks us what we wanna do with it. So we have the option of importing it as a footage, which is basically going to treat it as a still non-layered image. Or we can import it as a composition, or a composition with the layer sizes still remaining intact. So this is the one that we want, composition retain layer sizes. And then there's no layer styles on it, so it doesn't really matter what we pick here. But so we're just going to hit OK. And you'll see that After Effects made a comp. So if you double click that, you'll see the three layers that were in my Photoshop file. And because we kept the layers in their proper sizes, we can start to use them individually like this. So if you want to do multiplane, you can do that. I won't be going over that today, but I separated it just in case maybe you wanted to. And then last but not least, we're going to import in our textures. So go back to the footage, paper textures, and we're going to import in the three of them. And now we're all set. So we have all of our footage. Okay, and we're ready to get started. So we're gonna make a new comp, which is this button right here. It has like the little circle, triangle, square. We're gonna hit that. I'm gonna name this final comp. And the dimensions 1920 by 1080 is fine, because that's what my background was made for. And we're gonna set the frame rate to 12. And duration, we can make it 10 seconds long, so 120 frames. Okay. And then we're going to hit OK. So now we have our composition that we're going to be working in. So the first thing that we want to do is we want to key out the blue screen from the bird animation. So, yeah, question? Yep. So it's 1920 by 1080, square pixels, frame rate is 12, and duration is 120 frames, which is 10 seconds. Okay. So we're going to import in our we're going to drag in our bird animation and put it onto our composition. So it's a little big, but that's okay. Actually, scratch that, undo that. We're going to drag the bird animation to the new comp icon so that it makes a new composition out of this. And it'll keep the same dimensions. So, did everyone get that? You're just going to drag the bird animation, drag it to the new composition button, and then when you let go, it'll make a new comp that's the exact same resolution as the image sequence. So I'm going to flip this using the rotation. So if you select that layer and hit R, it brings up the rotation, and I'm going to hit 180 so that it flips. Okay. And then we are going to use a keying effect to key out the blue. So if you go into Effect, Keying, and Key Light 1.2, this is the one that we're going to be using. So select that. In rotation. So you select the layer, hit R, or you can just use the drop down menu to find rotation. Yeah, and then it's just 180 degrees. Flip it upside down.
I don't know if I missed
the
stuff
because I put one in and I didn't. No. Got it? Did you select the layer and do 180?
Oh, okay, now
we're. Yeah? Okay. Okay. Yep.
What do we connect? Is key cleaner or key light?
Key light 1.2.
Oh.
Yeah. Key light 1.2. And you should see it in the effect controls window now. If you don't see this, just go to Windows and effect controls is how you get to it. But you should see it. Okay. So the way this works, this is the most, at least from what I know of, the most effective keying effect in After Effects. And so we're going to select the color that we want to key out. So under screen color, you see the color box and an eyedropper tool. So we're going to click on that eyedropper right here. And it changes our cursor to an eyedropper. And we're just going to click on the blue, and it should key it out. If you don't see the transparency grid, the toggle switch for that is this one right here. It's like a grid. That's right beside the drop-down menu that says Active Camera. So this shows you that it's transparent. Okay? So right now, if I zoom into this, you'll see that it's taking away some of the transparency in my bird, which I don't want. And that was partly my problem because I made a puppet that had bluish colors in it, and then I used a blue screen, which is not the smartest thing to do. But that's all I had. So this is how we can fix that. So under the screen mat, you'll see there is clip black and clip white. So for the clip white, we're going to lower it, and it'll darken that inside until we don't see the squares anymore of the transparency grid. Okay? The only problem with this is that it's going to make the rest darker too, so anything that's semi-translucent, we can see it pretty clearly. So if I play it through, you guys kind of see that jittery effect around the edges. So it's not a very clean keying right now so far, because we've darkened it a little bit. Okay, so the way to work around that, we're lucky because this animation covers up a pretty small space. So what we can do is just mask it so that it only shows the area that we need. Okay, so we're going to select the rectangle tool that's at the top here. So select that, and then just kind of scrub through the timeline to see where the bird starts and where it ends. So it's somewhere around here, and then it ends somewhere around here. So I want to draw a box that will surround that area. And we can edit the box later, so it doesn't have to be perfect on the first try. So that looks pretty good, but I'm cutting it off a little bit here, so it was too low. And the way to edit it is to switch to the selection tool, which is the very top left, where you can hit V, and then we can just move that mask up. And let's see, And that's perfect. Okay, so I'm not cutting off anything, and it's masking out the rest of the image so that the black smudges don't show. Yep.
Can we, I know you can move around the square now, but what's the key to change the shape of the rectangle?
There's no key. You still use the selection tool. So you just click away so that the points aren't selected anymore, and then you can kind of edit the shape however you want it. So I'm going to change the background of the composition just to show you guys. You don't need to do this, but this is just to show you how clean the keying is. So as you can see, there's a lot of smudges that are here. And because we're using a proxy, the resolution doesn't look so great. So I'm going to go back to my project window by clicking the double arrow. And then I'm going to disable the proxy, just to check what it looks like in high res. Okay, so it's a good idea to always check back and forth from your high res to your proxy, just to see what the final image actually looks like. So it looks pretty dirty, and the way we can fix that is we can also mask out all these little specks. Okay, so we're gonna do the same thing. We're gonna use the rectangle tool, and we're just going to surround, let's say, make sure the layer is selected when you use a rectangle tool. Otherwise, it'll make a new shape layer. Okay, so have the layer selected. And then I'm going to draw a box around that first one. And you'll see that I just made a new mask called Mask 2. And under the drop-down menu where it says Add, I'm going to switch that to Subtract. And that will subtract that area from my footage. So we're going to do the same thing for the other ones. So I'm going to draw another box around this smudge. Go to my mask 3. Change it from add to subtract. And the same thing for the other one. So just keep doing that until you're happy with your result. Okay. So I got most of my big smudges, and that's good enough for me because we're going to be overlapping this with a paper texture. Now the problem that you'll see here, if I scrub back to the beginning, this mask is colliding with my bird in the start, which I don't want it to do. So a way to fix that is to actually animate this mask so that it moves with the bird frame by frame. So with that mask selected, so this is the brown one, and you'll see that After Effects has it color-coded for you. So I know that this one is Mask 5 for me. Okay. We're going to go into that mask. So click the drop-down menu. And in Mask Path, we're going to keyframe this. So go to the very first frame and hit the stopwatch. And that'll create your first keyframe. And then now, we're going to use hold keyframes instead of the linear keyframes because we don't want it to in between the mask shapes. And I'll show you why in a second. So we're going to right-click on that first keyframe that it just created. And here it says toggle hold keyframe. And that will change the shape of the keyframe to have like a square end. Okay, and what this will do is that it'll keep that shape until the next frame. It won't in between the shape, so my mask won't morph into the next one. It'll just keep that shape until the very next keyframe, it'll shift when I change the shape. So I'm just gonna go frame by frame and adjust this mask accordingly. So I'm gonna go back to my selection tool and kind of move this mask where I need it to go. So again, if you wanna adjust the point itself, you have to click away so that it deselects the points and select the point that you want. And then you can start adjusting the shape. Okay, so the first frame, I'm gonna do something like that. I just don't want it to collide with the bird, but still cover that spot. So I'm gonna go to the next frame, and the next frame still looks good. Next frame still looks good. The shortcut for going frame to frame is Command and arrow keys. So the left and right arrow key, if you wanna go with the keys. Okay, so in this frame, again, it's overlapping, so I need to move this one. So I'm just going to readjust the mask so that it doesn't cover my bird. And again, go next frame. And we're just going to keep doing this until the bird goes out of that range and we don't need to worry about it. Oops. Are there any questions so far? Everyone okay?
Can you say again how to go for the shortcut?
Shortcut is command and the arrow keys, so left and right. Oops. Okay, now I'm gonna have to move this mask back down because that spot is showing now that the bird is not on it. And then it should be good from here on because the bird is now out of that range. Okay? I'm going to zoom out and make sure that the other masks aren't colliding with the bird. And it looks pretty okay. I think this mask needs to be nudged a little bit. Okay. And now it's masked out. And this looks a lot cleaner than what we had before. So that's a quick way to fix things if your green screen isn't the cleanest footage. Yeah?
Did you toggle, when I do toggle transparency, I have a black background. Did you do any changes to the white background?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So you don't have to change the background, it doesn't make a difference. I just changed it to white so you guys can see. But if you right click on the composition setting. And you hit composition settings right here, you can change the background color. Yeah. But this actually doesn't affect it when you export it. It's still transparent if you export with an alpha channel. If there is no alpha channel, it just export it black. So don't rely on this background color thinking it's the background of your image. This is just so that, you know, if you want to work with a certain background color, like right now, white is pretty useful. That's how you would do it. Okay? So I'll give you a minute to catch up.
Can you say again how to, like, I understand how to change the form of my masks,
yep.
But how do I not change, like, I keep changing it even though I don't want to, I just want to move it.
So because it's toggle hold keyframes,
mm-hmm.
You don't need to keyframe it every frame. So if you don't need to move it, just go to the next frame.
But when I do need to move it?
When you do need to move it, you move it with the selection tool.
I understand.
Yeah.
When I'm clicking on it, like, let's say I accidentally clicked outside of it and I want to just go back. Is there a quick way to do that?
You can select it in the layers. So if you open up your layer and then go into your masks, just select whichever one it is that you need. It's not changing?
It's just like staying the same even though I didn't toggle.
So you're using what kind of keyframes? Like the linear or is it the same shape? Is it square?
Yeah, they look like that,
yeah.
But they're not
changing?
Yeah. Like as soon as I change it on one, it
will move. Are they all selected? Because that could be
that
make sure they're not selected. Well, you don't need to select it. You just go to that frame and then adjust it, but you can just click on one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, if you need to select it. Okay. Everyone good? Are we okay to move on? Yes? Okay. No response means yes. Okay, so One thing that I want to do with this footage, it's only 53 frames long. And if you remember our final comp, we made it 10 seconds. So I want this footage to be sent 10 seconds so that we can use it for the whole duration. So one way to do this, when I animated this particular shot, I made sure to animate a loopable sequence at the very end. So if you play it through, you'll see what I mean. It's just that wing flapping, I can loop that and extend it as much as I want. So one way to do that is to go to that frame that we want, where the loop starts, which I think was frame 27. So we're going to put our timeline cursor on frame 27, and you'll see your frame number here, if you need to know what frame you're at. Okay, and this is a really neat keyboard shortcut that I always use all the time. So it's Command Shift D, and you'll see that it duplicated the layer, but it trimmed each one to where my timeline cursor is. So it would have been the same thing as if I duplicated it and then, you know, adjusted my layer so that this one shows, this one stops showing and this one starts showing here, but it's just a shortcut to make things efficient.
Did you
make the shortcut?
You went on the layer and then you did Command Shift D?
Yep.
At 27,
yeah. It's a really useful shortcut for when you want to be splitting layers, but you don't want to have to keep trimming them to where you need them. So it's a handy one. Is it working? No? Do you have the layer selected?
Yeah.
Yeah, selected. And then, here, let me undo. Selected. Have your timeline cursor here. It's Command Shift D. And then it should do it automatically. No? Yeah, it's stretched out till 53, which is the whole sequence. Did you interpret your footage?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's at 12 frames. And it's not working?
Oh, wait.
Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. No worries. Okay, so I want to extend my composition to be 10 seconds long. So I'm going to right-click on the tab of the composition, which is right here. Right-click, composition settings. And I'm going to extend this to be 120 frames so that it's 10 seconds long. So under duration, just change it to 120. And we're going to hit OK. And if I zoom out, you'll see that I now have much more space. So we're going to use a very basic expression to loop it. Yeah?
My file is still using time code. How do I set it to frames?
You mean like here? You can hit Command and click it, and it'll toggle it. Yeah. Or do you mean in your composition, like in the settings? If not, just type in 10 seconds. It really doesn't matter. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Might not allow me to interpret the footage.
So when you go here, it doesn't allow you to interpret it?
Where's the, I can't see the mouse.
Oh. Right here? In the project window? Mm-hmm. If you right click, interpret footage.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So just double check that everything is in 12 frames per second. So this one, and then the proxy too.
Okay.
So interpret proxy, it's also at 12. So double check that. Okay?
Yes.
Perfect. So this is my loop that I'm going to loop even more to extend to 10 frames. So what we're going to do is we're going to right click on the layer, on the bar, not on the name, on the bar. And then we're going to enable time remapping. And what that will do is it's going to put two keyframes at the very beginning and at the very end of that layer. Did everybody get that? Right click on the layer, time, and enable time remapping. Okay? And then what we're going to do, since we want to loop just this section, I actually don't need this first keyframe. But before I delete it, I need to keyframe here so that I have the starting frame and the end frame. So I'm going to move my cursor to that very beginning of that second layer, hit the keyframe so that it makes a new keyframe, and then I can delete this first one. Okay? So the keyframe here should say 27, and then the very last one should say 53. And you'll see in the animation that frame 27 is actually the exact same as frame 53. So we don't want this last frame when we loop it, because otherwise it's duplicating the first frame, and it'll look like there's a pause every single time it loops. So we're going to go one frame back from the end of the layer. So this is 53. We're going to go to frame 52, keyframe it there so that it's at 52. I'm going to delete that last one because we don't need that last frame.
Sorry, how do you delete keyframes?
You're going to select it and just hit delete.
Thank you.
No problem. And we're going to trim this layer. Actually, we don't have to, but we'll trim it so that it's in line with the keyframes. And what we're going to do is we're going to add a very basic built-in expression that's going to loop this footage for us. You guys okay? So you're going to hold down the Option key, or the Alt key. Yeah? Okay. So we are now at the time remap, and we're going to loop this layer so that it lasts for the whole composition. Okay? So we're going to hold down Option key, and we're going to click on the stopwatch. So when you click it, this number should change to red. Okay? And then where it says expression time remap, you'll see a bunch of icons right beside it. We're going to hit on the arrow that pops up a menu. And under property, we're going to select loop out duration. And this is just a built-in expression in After Effects that will loop the footage for you. And it only works when you put the keyframes of the time remap where you want it to loop. Okay? Does everyone see that? The loop out duration under property. So I'm going to click on that. And if all goes well, I can now extend this, and it should loop seamlessly. So if I play it, now it's looping for the rest. Yeah? Right click on where? Did you put the expression on?
Yeah,
so it's just the arrow right here, where you see all the icons, yeah. And then it's property, and loop out duration. Yeah.
My bird just stopped flying.
Okay. Is it gone, or it just stopped?
Just stopped.
It just stopped? So that's something to do with your time remapping. If you keyframed it properly, it should work. Just make sure the first keyframe is 27. And this keyframe is 52. If you're working at the same frame rate as me, it should be the same numbers.
Yes.
Yeah? And it worked?
I have a right keyframe, but it doesn't fly.
Sorry?
Doesn't.
Does it fly during this, though? Like between the keyframes? Did you use a hold keyframe? You got this, Brenda? Okay. Yeah, they're gonna upload it somewhere, yeah, for sure. Yeah, I'm recording it as we speak, so It'll be uploaded. Yeah.
In terms of the proxy versus the high res,
yeah.
You say which, like, currently are you set to proxy or are you set to the high res?
The high res.
Okay, cool.
So if it's filled in, that's the proxy.
Thank you.
Yeah. And like I said, you won't notice on these computers because they're powerful enough to compute the high res, but if you're working on your own computer, you'll be like, okay, it's lagging. Yeah, you'll notice a difference. Yeah, that's why I'm not being picky about it right now. But
I just want to make sure I have two.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Okay, so we're just going to wait for Evie to catch up. Is there any questions while we're waiting? Anything you want me to clarify? Anybody stuck?
How's your phone coming?
It's good. It's good. It's coming. Slowly. Yeah. Yeah. It's like 2.5 months left. I'm starting to.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you guys need help?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So we have our loop now. And now we can import it. Composite it with our backgrounds. So we're going to go back into our final comp. And now we can drag in the comp that we made with the bird animation, which is this one, and drag that in. Okay, it's a little big right now, but that's okay. And then we're going to drag in our background comp. Okay, so it's this one. And you can rename these comps if it starts to get too confusing. So I'm going to drag that in to be under, and now I have my background with my bird. Okay, so make sure you're doing this in the final comp composition. So if you need to access that, go to your project window and double click on the final comp, and it'll open it up for you. Okay? So now I'm going to scale down my bird so that it's proportionate to my background. So I'm going to select that layer of the bird and hit S and scale it down until it's the size that I wanted it to be. And we can position it anywhere we want. I'm going to have it perched on this branch right here, somewhere like that. And you can move the layer just by having the selection tool and dragging it on the screen. So you can just drag it around as long as you have the selection tool selected. Okay. So now we're going to get into color correction. Right now, so this shot in my film was supposed to be a night scene. So I know that I want this to have a more bluish tone. And my bird right now looks too green for what I want it to be, because this tail is actually supposed to be blue. So when we keyed out the blue, it basically took away all the blue, so now it has a yellowish tint to the bird. So what we're going to do is we're going to add a curves, so it's under effect, color correction, curves, effect, color correction, curves. Okay. And now we have this graph that popped up on my effect controls window. Okay. So the curves tool is a really handy tool to not only adjust the exposure, but also the colors. Because if you go down to this drop-down menu, we have different channels that we can affect. So RGB is your white, so it's basically your brightness. And then there's the red, the green, the blue, and we can even affect the alpha. So if we want, we can clean up our green screen using the alpha channel. So the way it's going to work is it's going to read the alpha channel as if it's a grayscale image. So the black is 0% opacity, which is completely transparent. White, which is on the right side, is 100% opacity, which is not transparent at all. So So anything in between the gray is translucent, which is what we saw in like the edges of the keying, because we didn't get everything. So anything that's kind of faint will be a gray color. So if we actually lower this, if I click and drag the middle of the graph, and I'm just going to solo my bird so that you can see what I mean. If I click and drag it, you can see how it affects the alpha channel. If I'm just moving it around like this, right? It's affecting my alpha channel. So I just want to drag it down so that it takes away all the very faint black pixels that we saw. And that's another way to clean up your green screen, is to actually edit the alpha channel. Okay, and I'm going to unsolo this. And we're going to go into the blue channel. So in the drop-down menu, we're going to switch to blue, and I'm going to raise it. So I'm going to click on the middle again and just raise it so that it has a more bluish tint. So the way RGB works is it's not like your classic color wheel. The opposites are different. So the opposite of blue is yellow. So if I were to take away blue, if you look at my bird, if I were to lower the blue values, it's going to turn it yellow. Okay? If I go into my red, if I were to lower my red, meaning I'm taking away the red, it's going to look more cyan. Okay? And green, it's going to make it look more magenta. So you start to memorize the opposites, and that's how you start color correcting. So you look at an image and you think, this needs more red, so you'll raise the red values. Or this needs less blue, and I want it to be more yellow, so you lower the blue and it'll become more yellow. So I said I want this to be more blue because it's a night scene, so I'm raising the blue values. And just to add some contrast, I'm going to go into the green and do like a little S shape. So I'm going to click on this side and it'll make a node. I'm going to click on this side, it's going to make a second node, and I'm going to make it into an S shape. And that gives it a nice contrasted look. And this is a very common shape for when you're working with curves, especially even the RGB channel, which is, like I said, your brightness. So if I were to do that here, you can see that it brings down my dark values and brings up my light values. And that's a way to contrast it. But my image is already pretty dark, so I don't need to add more contrast to it. If anything, I would want to make it brighter because it's a little too dark. So if I'm on my RGB channel here, we're going to click on the middle and just raise it so that it brightens the whole image. And this is just affecting the bird because the curve's effect is applied to the layer of the birds. We're going to do it to the whole image soon so that the whole image has a bluish tint to it. Okay. Is everyone good so far? Yeah. So now what we're going to do is we're going to add an adjustment layer. So in Layer, New, Adjustment Layer. We're going to add the effect, the same effects. So effect, color correction, curves. And we're going to do a similar thing where we're going to raise the blue. So go to your blue channel and raise it. And this is going to affect my whole picture. So it gives it that bluish tint. And then we're going to switch to our green channel. And again, this is just kind of a trick that I've learned, is that green channel is nice for contrast, but you can start playing around with these colors. Like if you want a certain look, you can start raising maybe the green and the dark, or lowering the green to have it more like a magenta look. It's really just a creative decision. There's no specific rule as to what you should do. But for my personal taste, I liked it when I lowered the green in the darker values. So in this area, I lowered it, and then I raised it in the light colors, like that. So that's a little too much, so I'm just going to raise that one, like this. Okay. And this is just personal taste. So you guys come up with whatever you want. And I'm going to up the contrast in this one. So I'm going to go back to my RGB and do that S-curve again. And that will make it nice and contrasted. And a fun thing to do is to toggle this back on and off and see the huge difference it makes when you don't color correct and when you do. So this, right now, it looks like it's a night scene. This one, not so much. So it really does make a huge difference, even if you're just adjusting the color. Another effect that I like to use for color correction is photo filters. So it kind of has a similar effect. So under effect, color correction, there's also photo filters. And then if you take a look at that, you can pick different colors, or you can pick your own custom one by clicking here. Yeah. Photo filter.
Okay,
yeah.
Got it. Thanks.
No problem. So the one that I used was cooling filter LBB. And when I was making this film, I applied this filter to my entire film so that it unified all of my shots and all the colors looked similar. Okay, so this is a great way to make your film look a lot more polished and not have your shots kind of look like they're individual shots. So when these effects are also available in Premiere, so it doesn't have to be in After Effects. If you're editing in Premiere, you can just apply a photo filter to your whole film, and that's a really quick way of just making sure all your shots blend together. And if it's too strong, then you can tone down the density. So I'm going to put maybe 15. And that looks pretty good to me. So, okay. And again, this is before and after. Makes a huge difference. Yeah?
Last question. In general, when do we add the adjustment layer?
Adjustment layer is like it's a blank layer that you can apply effects to. So anything that's under the adjustment layer,
yeah,
it's going to apply everything.
Can we just edit the original effect layer?
Yeah, you can do that. Yeah.
Okay.
But it's a lot easier to use adjustment layers if you have like a lot of layers and you just want to apply it to the whole picture, right? But yeah, you can edit the background if you want.
So we use the adjustment layer, it's more convenient for us?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, it's just for convenience, yeah. I mean, what you could do is just like copy and paste those curves on every single layer that you have. But then it's hard to adjust it if you want to start tweaking
yeah.
things, right? Yeah, so it's the same thing, but it's just this is a more efficient way
sure.
to work, yeah. So now, just to add a little detail, right now the bird kind of looks very flat and as if it's on the same plane as the background. So one way to fix that is to do like a multiplane, but that's going to take too much time. So I'm going to show you a really quick trick of how to add a shadow to your animation. So what we're going to do is we're going to select the layer that has the bird animation. Okay. We're going to duplicate it. So it's Command D. And then we select the bottom one. And we're going to add an effect called fill. So it's effect, generate, fill. And this is just going to apply a color on top. Okay, so the default is bright red, and you can kind of see underneath what it's doing. We're going to change this to black. So you click on that color, the square here, and change it to black. And if I disable that top layer, you'll see that it's just covering it as a silhouette. Okay? And using my arrow keys, I have the bottom one selected, and I can offset this so that it looks like it's a shadow being casted. Okay, and we're gonna add a blur effect to it just to soften the edges. So we'll have the shadow layer selected, go to Effect, Blur and Sharpen, and we're gonna use Gaussian Blur. And I'm just going to raise it and see what I like. So maybe around 15. would be good. Maybe even more. Let's try 20. Just gonna zoom in and see what it's doing. Yeah, I think 25. I'm gonna leave it at 25. Okay, so it's still a little dark, so I'm going to lower the opacity on that. So with the shadow selected, you can either go in the drop-down menu or hit T for opacity. And I'm just going to lower this to like 15% opacity. And now I see that I've blurred it a little too much where I'm losing that edge. So I'm going to go back to my Gaussian blur effect and lower the blur to get a more crisp edge.
Did you say T was the short
edge? Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's wrong.
For opacity. Yeah.
Okay.
There's like no relation, but T for
okay.
opacity.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. And I'm going to set this to blending mode. So I'm going to right click on the layer. And under blending mode, I'm going to switch it to multiply. And that's just so that the shadow affects the colors nicer. Multiply is always a good blending mode for shadows. And now the bird stands out a little more from the background, which helps. Okay, so that's a really quick way of just adding a tiny detail that does make a big difference. Okay, so that is the end of part one. Okay, I'm gonna get started. Hopefully, she'll be back soon. I just don't wanna run out of time, so. Okay, so part two, we are going to, let's see. Okay, so first what we're going to do is we're going to add a new camera. It's okay, take your time. So it's under layer, new, camera, okay? And we're going to use a one-node camera. So we're gonna switch this to one-node and switch the 50 millimeter to 35 millimeter. We're gonna hit OK, and this gives us a warning that we don't have any 3D layers, but that's fine. We're gonna turn it on so that it's 3D. So in this little cube column here, we're gonna turn it on so that all these layers are 3D. You don't need to change the adjustment layer though. The adjustment layer you should keep as 2D, because otherwise it'll start moving with the camera, and we don't want that. Okay. No, you just, if you see the cube icon in that column, you're just going to switch that. Yeah, you're just going to switch it on.
The little icon box popped up that said once per session, or I don't know what it said. I clicked once per session, and I wasn't sure if that's what it looked like.
Once per session. Was that the warning that it's two layers?
Yeah, it came up after the two layer warning.
Oh. I'm not sure what that was then.
I'm not
sure. Okay, so here we can do a very basic camera move. So we're going to hit P on the camera. And maybe we'll go like around like here when the bird is at its highest. I'm going to keyframe it, so hit the stopwatch. And then when the bird is flying, I want the camera to reframe so that the bird is centered. So I'm going to move it in the X value, so where it says 960. I'm going to move it over like this and just center that bird. And if I play it back, my camera should be moving with my bird. Like that.
I can't get my camera to work, actually.
Did you turn on the 3D? What do you mean it's not working? You can't move it?
I
or?
Didn't turn on 3D.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you have to turn on the 3D, otherwise the camera won't work. Okay. Okay. And I want to easy ease these, so I'm going to select the keyframes. And I'm going to right-click Keyframe Assistant and Easy Ease. Or you can hit F9. Okay, and it'll change it into an hourglass shape. And that'll just smooth out the camera move a little more. Let me just play it back. It's a little fast, so I'm going to move this keyframe a little farther in the beginning so that it's slower. Yeah, that looks pretty good to me. Okay.
Sorry, can you explain again how to do the easy ease thing?
Yep, you're going to select the keyframes.
Select both of them?
Yep, both of them.
How do I do that again?
You can click and drag, or you can click it and then hold shift and click the other one.
Gotcha.
Okay, and then right click, keyframe assistant, easy ease. And now we're going to drag in our paper texture, which I think I used this one, the 29-05-13_paper07. So I'm going to drag that in to be under my bird animation, but on top of my background. Okay. So it's going to cover my background temporarily, but that's okay, because we're going to animate it so that it fades in. So I'm going to trim the layer so that it moves maybe around here. I want it to start fading in. So I'm going to have the layer selected, hit T, or you can just use the drop-down menu and find opacity. And I'm going to set it to 0. Hit the stopwatch to make a keyframe on the very first frame of that layer. And then once the camera is done moving, so where this keyframe is, I'm going to move my cursor there. I want this background to be fully visible. So I'm going to set that as 100. So it's going to fade in as the camera is moving. Okay. Now I don't really like the color of this paper. So this is another way where you can use color correction. So we're going to use the same tools. Actually, we're going to use one new effect. So it's effect, color correction, hue saturation. If you select that, you can start changing the hue of the paper, the saturation, the lightness, and you can really just change the color of that paper. So I kind of wanted it to be like a brownish paper, so I'm gonna make it something like that. Okay. So just play around with it until you're happy. And we can do the same thing, like adding curves, adding a photo filter, anything you want, just to get the color that you want. So I'm gonna add a curves to it. So again, it's effect, color correction, curves. And then I can up the contrast if I want by using the S curve like that. I can go into my color channels and raise the red if I wanted to have more of a red tint, things like that. Okay, that was a little too much purple for my liking, so I'm gonna raise the green, not by too much. And that I think that looks good. Okay.
How did you get it to the brown?
To the brown? So I adjusted the hue, so I did it around 30. for the hue, and then in the curves, I raised the red and raised the green a little. You don't need to use these particular effects. I mean, there's other ways of getting it, but the hue saturation is a quick way of being able to change the color of something. You know, all of these effects, they're used as tools. So it's not like this is specifically for this task. A lot of the tools that I use in After Effects, I use them for a purpose that they weren't made for, right? Like, they're just a whole box of tools that you kind of grab and use whenever you need them. So it really doesn't matter which ones you use as long as you get the end result that you want. Okay, is everyone okay? Is it all right if we move on? Yep.
I'm having a problem with my toggle.
Your toggle,
my
which one?
For some reason, I can't add like more than one.
You can't add more than one.
Yeah.
You mean, so you're in your opacity?
No, sorry. In just for the basic camera, I can't get more than one.
Did you hit the stopwatch?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, and then if you move to a different frame, and then you move the camera, it should automatically make a keyframe for you.
For some reason it disappears when I...
And then, got it? Okay, perfect. Thank you. Okay, so now we have the transition done from the first part to the second part. So what we're going to do is we're going to select all the layers. So I'm going to hold shift. I have the camera layer selected. Hold shift and select the bottom layer so it selects all of the layers. Or you can just click and drag and select all of them, whichever way. So with all the layers selected, I'm going to right-click on them and hit Pre-Compose. And I'm going to name this Part 1. Okay, and then you just hit OK. And now everything is pre-composed into one composition. And this is a good way to organize yourself, to group things, because After Effects doesn't have folders and things like that, which is really, I don't know why. It would be so useful if they would have folders in the layer section, but they don't. So this is a workaround. This is one way to kind of group your layers together so it doesn't get so messy. Because we're going to be applying an effect to this. So it's a way to treat this as one whole and just one panel instead of a bunch of layers that are composited together. Okay? So we are going to duplicate this. We're going to hit Command-D and duplicate that. I'm going to rename the top one by hitting Enter. And I'm going to rename it Bottom Half. And then select the bottom layer and rename it Top Half. So it's reversed. So bottom half is on top and top half is on bottom, okay? So we're going to bring in another paper texture, which I think is this one. So ripped paper PNG 69537. This one in your project window. And I'm going to drag that in. Okay. So once I have that in my composition, I'm going to move it up so that this rip is kind of like halfway of the frame. Doesn't have to be perfect. It's somewhere halfway, okay? And what we're going to do is we're going to use something called track mat. So track mats are very handy. You can use them for multiple purposes. So this is one of the ways you can use them. So with the bottom half layer selected, here we need to switch our modes so that we can see the track mat option. And the way to do that is there's a button at the bottom of your timeline that says toggle switches modes. Right here. I don't know if you can see that. Okay, and if you click that, then a different menu pops up. Okay. And under the track mat column, where it says TRK mat, this is the track mat. So in the drop down menu here, I'm going to pick alpha inverted mat. And what this means is that it's going to take the alpha channel of the layer that's on top and flip it. So it's going to reverse the alpha channels. So here, this picture, the alpha channel is going to look something like this part is white and this part is black because this part is a transparent part. So remember, alpha, the alpha mat is like a grayscale image. So white is opaque, black is transparent. So I'm going to do alpha inverted mat. And you won't see a difference here, but if I disable that top half, you'll see that it masked out that top part. Okay? So we're going to do the same thing to the top half, but we're going to use the reverse so that the top half shows at the top and the bottom is transparent. So I'm going to make the bottom half layer invisible for now, just so that it's easier to work with. I'm going to drag in that ripped paper texture again, put it on top of the top half layer. Okay, it has to be right above the top half. It can't be up top here. It has to be right above it because the track mat will read the layer that's directly above the layer that has the track mat. Okay, so we're going to do the same thing under the track mat column. We're going to switch this. This time to the alpha mat. We don't need to invert it because, before we do that, I'm going to delete this actually, and we're going to duplicate the one that we already did because I repositioned this already. So I'm going to delete that. And I'm going to duplicate this one instead because it's already in a certain position and I need it to be in the exact same position. So I'm going to duplicate this and move it so that it's right above the top half. Okay? Did everybody get that part?
I don't remember how to get the track
mat. How do you do it? Switch or?
Yeah, how to get the switch on there.
Yeah, it's the toggle switches and the modes.
Switches?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay, so in the top half, I'm going to select alpha mat. You double-clicked it, so you're in the wrong window. You'll see you're in this one. You just have to click on this one. Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to make the bottom half visible again and make the texture invisible. So all I see is the bottom half and the top half. And you should, if everything went well, you should see this seam right here. If you don't see it, then there's something wrong. Okay? If you don't see it, let me know. No?
No.
So,
one half is working, but the other one is not.
Okay, did you do alpha mat, not alpha inverted mat?
For
the
top
half is alpha mat. Bottom half, is alpha inverted mat. Because we want the opposites. So top, bottom half, alpha inverted mat. Yeah. And the top half is alpha mat. Oh, did you make it invisible? Yeah, turn the eye icon on.
Turn the eye icons off on one of the ripped pieces of paper.
You want the paper, both of them, to be invisible, and then the bottom half, top half to be visible.
Yeah, that's not one.
Okay, moving along. So we don't want to see the seam. Okay, so what I want to do is I'm going to move this up so that the bottom half covers that seam. So what I'm first going to do is I'm going to parent that texture to the layer beneath it, so that when I move this layer, this moves with it. Okay? So when you parent a layer, it basically attaches itself to the parent layer. And whenever you move the parent layer, its child is going to move with it. Okay? So selecting the bottom half, I'm just going to nudge it up with the arrow keys until that seam is gone. And now I'm going to select the bottom half with the track mat, so the top two layers, and I'm going to pre-compose it. So with the two selected, I'm going to right click, pre-compose, and then we can name this bottom half pre-comp.
And
when yeah?
You touch my, oh, sorry.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. When I move it up, I get, like, I reach the bottom of my layer, so I've got a big transition.
Okay. What you can do is you can scale the whole thing. So select all the layers, hit S, and then just scale it up until the whole thing is covered.
Right.
Yeah?
That
work? Okay. What was your question?
The same thing.
Same thing? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So has everybody pre-comped it? So just to repeat that, you're going to select the top two, right-click, pre-comp. And then I'm going to name it bottom half pre-comp. Okay. And now we're going to add that page turn effect. So we're going to go into effect.
Sorry, Annie.
Yeah.
I'm still trying to fix that problem. Can
you
explain one more time what you just did?
The pre-comp?
Yes.
Yeah. So you have the top two layers selected. Right click.
Yep.
Pre-compose. Okay. No problem. So with that bottom half pre-comp selected, we're going to go into our effect, and it's under distort, CC page turn. What?
No off.
No off.
Oh.
Yeah.
Is that better?
That's like super
Woo!
Dark.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Is that better?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Sure.
Oh,
well. Work in the darkness.
Okay. Don't fall asleep.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to select that page turn effect. And you'll see it that it applies. Guys?
Yes.
Yes. So here you'll see this little cursor, like little circle with a cross in the middle. Oop. It's not... As soon as we turn the lights off,
yeah, see?
People
are going to turn the lights back on. It'll stop it.
You're going to lose your privileges, guys. You have to pay attention.
We've all lost them.
So if I play around with this little guy here, the circle with the cross in the middle, don't get confused with the anchor point. It's this guy here. You can start seeing the page turn.
See, I'm going to turn them. You guys are unbelievable.
Okay.
Oh my god.
So because we split it up from the bottom half and the top half, this is why this works.
Oh my god.
Guys, breathe. It's okay. It's just a computer.
But it kind of looks cheesy, right? Like, not gonna lie, it doesn't look very real. So, what we're going to do, so one thing that makes it look so fake is that it's like a completely straight edge right here, right? So when we animate this, it's like we're ripping a piece of tape. It doesn't look like it's a piece of paper, right? So a way to fix that is through the fold radius. So I'm going to raise this all the way up to something like 500. And what that does is it raises the radius of that curve so that it's much rounder and the whole thing is curved. Okay? So that makes it look much more like a piece of paper. Okay? Another thing that I'm going to fix is the back opacity. It's set to 85 right now, so it kind of looks translucent. We want that to not be translucent at all, so we're going to set it to 100. And now you won't see through it. And then one more thing that we're going to fix is this highlight that looks very ugly. And I found the only way to really work around it is to make it into shadow instead. So in the light direction, I'm changing the angle so that the light is pointing from the opposite end and this side is cast into shadow. Okay, so in light direction, you'll see it here. So I'm at 74 degrees. Looks pretty good. Okay. Because this is a piece of paper, it shouldn't be shiny, right? So you can kind of see, you can preview this like this if you just play around. So what we're going to do right now, because this is not animated, so we have to keyframe this the fold position. So I'm going to set it back to its 0 point, and in the fold position, so around, let's say the bird flaps a few times. So maybe around here we want it to start ripping. So I'm going to keyframe it here by clicking the stopwatch on the fold position. And then in order to see where our keyframes are with the layer selected, we're going to hit U. And what U does is it brings up any keyframes that are applied to that layer. Okay, so I see my keyframe is here right now, and I'm going to go a few frames over, maybe like 20 frames over, and then animate this to go all the way to the other side until the whole thing is ripped. I'm going to zoom out so that I can see, like that. Okay, and if I scrub through, I'll see that that's animated. It's just the middle mouse button. You just scroll. Yeah, scroll in and out. Yeah, I have the same problem where I have a transparent bar in the middle. So I'm going to do the same thing I told you guys. Just going to scale it up. Okay. So now, if I play that back, it still looks kind of robotic, and I actually don't have it completely folded down for some reason. Just a second. I'm gonna scale it a little more. There we go. Okay. So right now, this is a very linear animation, right? It looks like it's just getting ripped straight. And we kind of want to break that so it looks more organic. So in between the two keyframes that we just made, it can be anywhere you want. Just move the fold position so that it doesn't follow a straight line. Okay, so I'm going to select the fold position so I can see that the little cursor again. And then in the middle of the two keyframes, I'm just going to shift this anywhere I want. And this will break up that linear movement. So it's going to go up and then kind of downwards. And it creates more of an arc, okay? And that's just an extra detail. You don't have to do it, but it's all the extra details that make it look realistic. And we can easy ease these keyframes so that it looks a lot smoother. So we're going to select all the keyframes by clicking and dragging. Right click, keyframe assistant, easy ease. And that'll smooth it out. And if it's too fast, one quick way to adjust the speed, if you have all the keyframes selected, you can hold down the Option key, and then if you drag the last keyframe, it's going to stretch it out proportionately. Okay, so that's another trick that you can use that's pretty useful. And it actually kind of, it stops in the middle. Oh, I know why, because we added an easy ease. So right now, I don't know if it's doing it for you guys. It kind of like rips, stops, and then rips again. And that's because we've easy eased this one. And I don't want this to be easy eased. If I go into the graph editor, you'll see what I mean. So right now, it's going, it's speeding up, slowing down, then speeding up again. And really what I want is just a smooth transition into this one. So with that middle one selected, the graph editor is here. So you can toggle it back on and off by selecting this icon. I'm going to select that middle one and then make it into linear. So it's this icon here with the two diagonal squares. It's the third one after the diamond, which is this one here. And that'll make it straight. And it won't plateau in the middle. Okay? And that looks a lot smoother. Yep.
I need help getting the page to rip. Like, mm-hmm.
It's not the anchor point. It's the fold position.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you have that selected, a little, this little circle will show up. It'll be somewhere on your screen.
Okay.
Yeah. So see how this is moving?
Yes.
That's what's animating it. Okay. Did you find it?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Perfect. So you're going to keyframe that one. So you keyframe it here so that it's completely flat and keyframe it until it's all ripped. And then in the middle, we just kind of added an extra one to break up that straight line.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So that looks pretty good. And we are almost done. We're getting to our final stages. Yeah!
Yeah.
So right now, this is transparent, and that might bring up a problem when you start exporting. So a safe thing to do is to add a solid at the bottom of your comp so that you don't have any transparent areas. So it's under Layer, New, or sorry, I need to have this window selected. Layer, New, Solid, or Command Y if you want to do the shortcut. And then I'm going to pick a black solid. Okay. Hit OK. And it made it on top. I'm just going to drag it so it's at the very bottom. And now I don't have any transparent area. Right? Even if I toggle this back on and on, it doesn't make a difference. And then the final touch is to add the text where it'll get revealed. So you can add anything you want. You're going to use the text tool, which is the T at the top of your toolbar. And hit anywhere in the timeline and type whatever you'd like. So let's say After Effects Workshop. And then here is where you'll edit the font and things like that, where it says character. So I'm going to select my text, and I'm going to go to the paragraph panel and change it to center justify so that it's centered in my comp. And then if I want to make it bigger, I can. If I want to change the font, I can. You can do anything you want. In paragraph.
was left of center. I have no idea why that would do.
You might have clicked off center. If that's the case. Yeah, so if you select, if you use the selection tool and then select that layer, if you go into, it doesn't show align, so go to Windows, Align, and it'll pop up a new window, and you're going to hit the second icon where it says Horizontal Center Alignment, and it'll center it into your composition. And make sure the text is underneath the top half, bottom half comps that we made. So it's right above the black solid and underneath the rest of the comps. So that when the page is ripped, that's where it gets revealed. Like that. Okay?
Where do I get the line? Because it's not showing up on...
Yeah, so it's on window.
Okay.
And then align. Get it to show. And it should show up on the side here.
Okay.
The window where I get the you just use the text tool and click anywhere on the screen. I just added a solid. Yeah, so it's layer, new, solid. Okay, and then you select the color in here. So you select that box and then you pick your color, hit OK, and then hit OK again. And then it'll make a new solid and you're going to bring it to the bottom so that it's the very bottom layer. Perfect. And the very last thing that we're going to do is we're going to add a camera so that we can scroll down to our credits. So we're going to hit new, camera, and we're going to use the same settings that we used last time. So one node, 35 millimeters, hit OK. Make sure everything is turned on for the 3D. So we're going to toggle the switches so we see the 3D icon again. So remember there's this button at the bottom of your timeline, the toggle switches slash modes, so that we can go back to see the 3D option enabling. Okay, and we're going to enable the 3D. We're not going to enable the 3D on the black solid, just on the comps and the text. Then we're going to keyframe the position of the camera. So we're going to have this camera layer selected, hit P. And then let's say we want it to start moving around 60 frames. So we'll hit the stopwatch so that we create a keyframe. Move a few frames down, maybe to like 110. And then using the Y value, which is the middle value here, where it says 540, I'm going to move it down by sliding it till everything is off screen. And you can add another text layer here if you want to add credits. If I play it back, it looks something like that. Cue end credits. And you can easy ease these keyframes too if you want it to look more gradual. So the way to do that, again, just to remind you, you select keyframes, right click, keyframe assistant, easy ease. Okay. And now we have our end credits. Yep.
I just need to know how to transition from the first background to the second one, because I wasn't here for that.
Oh, yeah. That's pretty simple. So if you go into the part one comp, part one.
Okay.
Do you have that comp?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So all you have to do is you're going to bring in the texture file that is this one, 29-05-13.
Okay.
And then you're going to bring it in to be the second bottom layer, so right above the background. Okay.
Okay.
And then we made it so that it fades in. So I'm going to move it, I'm going to trim it so that it starts, you know, when the bird is kinda in mid-flight.
Okay.
And you hit T with the layer selected. And we're going to make a 0% opacity first. Okay?
Okay.
Then you hit the stopwatch so that you keyframe it. Move a few frames over and change that to 100 so that it fades in. And it should work. And if you want to change the color, we just did it through color correction, like the same methods that we did for the other background.
Yes.
So using curves. And we used a hue saturation to change the hue of it and the saturation and things like that if you want to change the color of the background. Okay, so that's about it. So if you want to render it out, you just do file, file, export, add to render queue. And you want to make sure that it's exporting the full resolution and not the proxy. So you click on best settings, and right here where it says proxy use, it's already at use no proxy, so that's good. That's what we want. If you wanted to use the proxies so that it's a faster render and this isn't your final version, it's just a draft, then you would use the use all proxies or use comp proxies only. But if this is your final render, then you want it to have no proxies. And then for the codec, you would do normal, so QuickTime, and then in format options, that's where you would get the H.264. Format options, right here. Click that, and in the drop down menu, just pick H.264. And just hit OK. And then output 2, we're going to pick where it's going to output it. So let's just put it to our desktop. You can name it whatever you want. Hit save, and then hit render. And one trick for when rendering After Effects, if you hit caps lock, it's going to disable the live preview, so it renders it faster. Caps lock. Yeah, if you turn on caps lock, like if I turn it off right now, it's showing me frame by frame what it's rendering, and that actually takes more time to render because it's producing that frame for me to watch, but I don't need to watch it, so I'm going to turn on caps lock, and that disables that function so that it renders faster.
Can you go to the exporting? If you guys want, you can post your rendered videos on the Facebook event page. I like to see them.
But be careful because nowhere else, right? This is Annie was kind enough to lend us material from her film.
Yeah.
So nowhere else, please. Just the Facebook page.
Yeah.
That's it.
Tear up your spine.
Thank you, Annie.